Hello everyone, so in this video we will be discussing all the quantitative aptitude questions which were there in mock test 1, the free mock test which we provided for Wipro Elite NTH. So before we proceed, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel since we'll be posting various placement preparation videos. And also after watching this video, don't forget to comment on this video and share your feedback. Also join our Telegram channel. The link to the Telegram channel is given in the description of this video. Check this question. K required ₹800 for paying her fees. Okay. So ₹800 required to pay fees. She borrowed 20% from her brother. So 20% of 800 will be equal to 160. Okay. Since 10% of 800 is 80, 20% will be 160. And 30% of the remaining was funded by her mother. So she needed 800. Now how much amount is remaining to be funded? It is 640, right? So 30% of 640, this much amount was funded by her mother. Okay, so you can check this, how much it will be. 180 plus 12, that is 192. Okay, so 160 she got from her brother. 192 she got from her mother. She has ₹200 in her bank. Now they are asking how much more does she need. Okay, so she got 160 plus 192 plus 200. Okay, so you can just check how much amount this will be. This will turn out to be 552. Okay, so total she needed 800. She has arranged 552. So now she will require more, 248. Okay, so the correct answer for this question is ₹248. A bag contains 2 yellow, 3 green and 2 blue balls. So 2 yellow, 3 green and 2 blue balls. 2 balls are drawn at random. What is the probability that none of the balls drawn is blue? Okay, so total there are 7 balls. Out of that they are drawing 2 balls. So sample space or total possible outcomes will be 7C2. Okay, we know that probability is nothing but number of events divided by number of sample space. Okay, so sample space is 7C2. Why? Because total there are 7 balls and they are drawing 2 balls. So 7C2. Now we need to calculate the number of events. So what is the event? What would they want? They want the probability that none of the balls drawn should be blue. How many balls are there that they are not blue? 2 yellow and 3 green. So there are total 5 balls which are not blue. Out of that we'll be getting 2 balls. So the event will be 5C2. So probability will be 5C2 divided by 7C2. So 5C2 will be 5 into 4 divided by 2. 7C2 will be 7 into 6 divided by 2. Okay. So here you can just calculate this. This will be 20 by 42, which is 10 by 21. So the correct answer for this question is 10 by 21. In the beginning, Ram works at a rate such that he can finish a piece of work in 24 hours. Okay. So Ram can finish a piece of work in 24 hours. So I can consider total work as 24 units. Okay. He can complete, time required is 24 hours. Total work I have considered as 24 units. What will be the rate? Rate is nothing but work done per hour. Work done per hour, if he is taking 24 hours for 24 units, he will do 1 unit per hour. Okay, this is the LCM method which we are using. Okay, in LCM method we take the LCM of the time taken. Okay, so here time taken only one person is there, Ram. So LCM of 24 is 24. So now I have got that Ram completes 1 unit in 1 hour. Now what they are saying, but he only works at this rate for 16 hours. So only for first 16 hours, he is working at 1 unit per hour rate. After that, he works at a rate such that he can do the whole work in 18 hours. So I'll again write here Ram, he can complete the whole work in 18 hours. And we know that the total working units is 24 units. So now just calculate the rate or work done per hour. Work done in per hour, it will be how much? He takes 18 hours for 24 units. So in 1 hour, he will complete 24 by 18, which is 4 by 3 units per hour. Okay, so previously he was doing 1 unit per hour. After working for 16 hours, he shifts to this rate, and this rate is 4 by 3 units per hour. Okay, now what they are saying, if Ram is to finish the work at a single stretch, how many hours will he take to finish the work? Now let us check. He completes 1 unit per hour for first 16 hours. Okay, so he will complete 16 units, right? We know that total work is 24 units. Out of that, in first 16 hours, he completes 16 units. Now how much work is remaining? Remaining work is now 8 units. Now for this work, he is working at the rate of 4 by 3 units per hour. So here the time taken will be how much? 8 divided by 4 by 3, which will be equal to 6 hours, right? So initial 16 hours and then 6 hours, he will take total 22 hours to finish the whole work if he works at a stretch. Okay, what we did initially, they told us that he takes 24 hours to complete the whole work. So we consider 24 units as the total work. From that we got his rate as 1 unit per hour. Later they said that after working 16 hours, he changes his rate. Now his rate is how much? His rate is such that he can complete the whole work in 18 hours. That means to complete 24 units, he just takes 18 hours. At that rate, he is working. So how much is that rate? 24 divided by 18, that is 4 by 3 units per hour. Now this rate comes into picture only after 16 hours. For first 16 hours, he is working only at the initial rate of 1 unit per hour. Now if he is working continuously, they are asking us how much time he will take for 24 units. Out of 24 units, he will complete 16 units in 16 hours, working at 1 unit per hour. And remaining 8 units, he will be completing at 4 by 3 units per hour. So if he is doing 4 by 3 units per hour, to complete 8 units, he will take 8 divided by 4 by 3, which is 6 hours. So total, he is going to take 16 plus 6, that is 22 hours to complete the whole work. Check this question based on average. Average marks of 40 students was calculated to be 52.15. So I can say average is equal to total marks of 40 students. Okay, I have taken T40, you can take XYZ, anything. T40 I have denoted as total marks of 40 students divided by 40. We know that average is sum upon number. So total marks of 40 students divided by 40 is 52.15. It was later discovered that marks of a student were taken to be 49 instead of 85. So actually the student's marks were 85, but by mistake they have taken 49. So now we need to calculate the real average. Now just check how much less marks they have taken. They have taken 36 marks less, right? That means this total is less by 36. The real total of that class is T40 plus 36. Why I have done plus 36? Because in this T40, there was one student whose marks were 85, but they have taken 49. That means they have considered 36 marks less in the total. So this is the real total divided by number of students. So this is the average. Okay. So now we need to calculate this. Okay. How we can calculate? We know that T40 is equal to 52.15 into 40. Right, so how I can calculate this? So I can write it as 521.5 into 4. What I did in 40 is 4 into 10, so I multiplied 10 over here. Okay, so T40 will be 52 or 521.5 into 4. This is T40, okay, divided by 40 plus 36 divided by 40. I have just separated it over here so that it becomes easy for calculation. This will become 521.5 into 4 upon 4 into 10, that is 40. This will become 9 by 10. So I can cancel 4, I can cancel 10, and this will become 52.15, and this is 0.9. okay, so this will become how much? It will become 53.05. So the real average of the class is 53.05, which is the answer. The average salary of 30 officers in a firm is rupees 120, and the average salary of laborers is rupees 40. Find the total number of laborers if the average salary of the firm is rupees 50. Okay, let's start this. So let's solve this problem stepwise. Average salary of 30 officers is 120. So I can say average is 120 will be equal to total salary of all 30 officers. Okay. Divided by number of officers is 30. So I can say total salary of all 30 officers is 3600. Okay. Next, the average salary of laborers is 40. So 40 is equal to total salary of all laborers divided by number of laborers. We don't know the total salary. We don't know the number of laborers, but we know the average. Now we need to find the total number of laborers. If they are saying average salary of the firm is rupees 50. So average salary of firm is 50, which will be equal to total salary of those 30 officers plus total salary of laborers. So this is the total salary of all the employees in the firm divided by total number of employees are 30, number of officers plus number of laborers. Now we need to find number of laborers. So we need to substitute T30, that is total salary of 30 officers, and TL, that is total salary of laborers, with something else. So how we can substitute, just check. T30 will be 3600 as we calculated previously, plus total salary of laborers will be equal to, I can say 40 multiplied by number of laborers. So I can say 40 number of laborers upon 30 plus number of laborers. Okay, so now in this equation there is just number of laborers remaining, so we can easily solve this now. So let's check what are the number of laborers. Will be equal to 3600 plus 40 NL. Okay, so here it will be 3600 plus 40 NL. Okay, so 10 NL is equal to 2100. So number of laborers is equal to 210. So the correct answer for this question is 210. Number of laborers are 210. Okay, check this question. This question is based on the concept of clock. What they are saying, the minute hand of a clock overtakes the hour hand at intervals of 64 minutes of correct time. How much does the clock gain or lose in 12 hours? Okay, first of all, you need to know that hour hand and minute hand coincide. Okay, coincide means the same meaning is that overtakes. Okay, the minute hand overtakes every 65 by 11 minutes. Okay, so you need to always remember this. If you have studied clock concept previously, this concept is very important. Hour hand and minute hand coincide every 65 by 11 minutes. Okay, so I'll just give you a small example. So if it is 12 in the clock, hour hand and minute hand are on the same number, so they have coincided, right? So again, when they will coincide, they will coincide at 55 by 11 minutes past 1. Okay, so the difference between this time is 65 by 11 minutes. Okay, so after every 65 by 11 minutes, the hour hand and minute hand coincide, or I can say that the minute hand of the clock overtakes the hour hand of the clock. So this happens after every 65 by 11 minutes. Now what they are saying, in the clock which is there in the problem, this coincide is happening in 64 minutes of true time. So when the correct, suppose we say that one is correct clock and another one is a defective clock. Defective clock is the one which is discussed in the problem. So in correct clock, when 64 minutes are elapsed, in defective clock, it is elapsing 65 by 11 minutes. Why? Because it is told that when true time 64 minutes are covered, the defective clock minute hand overtakes the hour hand. So that means in defective clock, these many minutes have passed. So that means if any clock coincide before this timing, then it is gaining time. If any clock takes more time to coincide than 65 5 by 11 minutes, then it is losing time. So currently you can check the current clock is coinciding 64 minutes of correct time. So it is going to gain time. Okay. So now let's check how much time it is gaining. In 64 minutes, it is gaining 15 by 11 minutes. Okay. How much it is gaining? 15 by 11 minutes. How? Just check here. Difference of 65 5 by 11 minus 64 is 15 by 11. So for every 64 minutes, it is gaining 15 by 11 minutes. They are asking how much it will gain in 12 hours. So 12 hours is how much? 12 hours is 12 into 60 minutes. How much it will gain? So you have to just cross multiply. So 15 by 11 is nothing but, you can say 11 on the 11, 11 plus 5 is 16 by 11, right? So this is 16 by 11 minutes. So just check here, x will be equal to 12 into 60 into 16 upon 64 into 11. So we can just solve this. 16 gets cancelled. So this will be 180 by 11 minutes. So this should be equal to 11 ones are 11, 11 6 are 66, 4 by 11 minutes. Okay. So in 12 hours, it is gaining 16 4 by 11 minutes. The correct answer is 16 4 by 11 minutes. This question is based on the concept of ratio proportion. Just check. The ratio of first and second class fares between two stations is 6 is to 4. So the ratio of fares is 6 is to 4. And the number of passengers traveling by first class and second class is 1 is to 3. So number of passengers ratio is 1 is to 30. Sorry. If rupees 2100 is collected as fare, so total fare collected is 2100. Then they are asking us what is the amount collected from first class passengers. Okay. So just check over here. You can say, suppose I take common multiple x. So 6x will be the fare of first class. 4x will be the fare of second class. Here the number I can take common multiple y. Number of passengers traveling by first class is y. And number of passengers traveling by second class is 30y. Now the fare collected will be how much? The fare price multiplied by number of people, right? So the fare collected for first class will be 6xy and the fare collected for the second class will be 4x into 30y, that is 120xy. Okay, this is the fare collected for second class. So together the fare collected is how much? 2100. Okay. But here if you check the ratio between the fare collected for first class and second class will be how much? It is going to be 1 is to 20, right? So this is the ratio of fare collected. Okay, ratio of fare collected of first class and second class is 1 is to 20. So I can say, I can take one common multiple over here, n. N plus 20n will be equal to the total fare collected, right? So 21n is 2100, n will be equal to 100. So I can say the fare collected from first class is 100 and the fare collected from second class is 2000. Okay, initially what we did? We calculated the fare collected by first class, calculated the fare collected by second class. If we directly solve this equation, it is not possible to solve. So what we did, we found out the ratio of the fare collected by first class is to fare collected for second class. The ratio was 1 is to 20 and we know that the total fare collected is 2100. So we have taken another common multiple over here, n into 1, that is fare collected for first class. N into 20, fare collected for second class. Together, the fare collected is 2100. So I got the value of common multiple as 100. So fare collected for first class will be n into 1, that is 100. And fare collected for second class will be 2000. So the answer for this question is 100. Read this question. This question is based on the concept of partnership. Joe started a business and he invested 38,000 rupees. Okay. After some months, Amar came to join with him and he invested 28,500 rupees. At the end of 1 year, the total profit was divided among them in the ratio of 16:8. That is nothing but 2:1. Okay. So this is nothing but the profit ratio. Okay, I'll write here. And the time for profit is 1 year. That is 12 months. Now what we need to find? We need to find how many months after did Amar join. Okay. So first, this is the investment of Joe and Amar. Let us check for how much time they invested their money. Joe started the business. He does not leave in between. So the time he invested was 12 months. Amar came after some time. We don't know how much time. Let us consider he invested money for X months. Now we know that profit ratio is equal to investment multiplied by time. Okay. So investment of Joe multiplied by time of Joe is to investment of Amar multiplied by time of Amar. This is the profit ratio. This will be equal to 2:1 because they have already given us the profit ratio. So this equation is in the form like A:B is equal to C:D. So we know that if there is such kind of equation, we can say A/B is equal to C/D. So from this I can write 38,000 into 12 divided by 28,500 into X is equal to 2/1. Okay, so I can just cancel this. I can just solve now. Okay, so X will be equal to 380 into 6 upon 285. So let me just calculate. So 19 3 is 57, 19 4 is 76. So this X will be equal to 8 months. Now X is 8 months, but answer is not 8 months. X is 8 months means Amar invested his money for 8 months. But they have not asked that. They have said, find after how many months did Amar join. If he was there for 8 months, that means he has joined after 4 months. Why? Because we have considered 1 year business, that is 12 months. He joined after 4 months. That means for remaining 8 months, his money was invested. If they would have asked for how much time his money was invested, then 8 months would have been the answer. They asked after how many months Amar joined. So the answer is 4 months. So in this problem, you have to simply use the Bodmer's rule to solve this particular expression. 3/7 of 4/5 of 20 bracket 25 square minus 24 square. Okay, so we can just solve this. First, we have to solve the bracket. So for this 25 square minus 24 square, this is nothing but a square minus b square. So a square minus b square is nothing but a plus b into bracket a minus b. Okay. So just check what will happen now. 3/7 into 4/5 into 20 into 49 into 1. So this will be 7 7 the 49. This will be 5 4 the 20. So 12 into 28. So this will turn out to be 336. Let's solve this question. Very interesting question based on pipes and cisterns. There are three taps, A, B and C, can fill a tank in 12, 15 and 20 hours respectively. Initially, taps A and B are open. If tap A is open all the time, while only one tap between B and C is open for 1 hour each, alternately starting with B, the tank will be full in how many hours? Before proceeding, first we need to find the rate of this each tap. So how will we find? First we will be finding the capacity of the tank. Capacity of the tank is nothing but LCM of 12, 15 and 20. LCM of 12, 15 and 20 is 60. So capacity of tank is 60 units. Okay. Those who don't know how to find LCM, just for them I will solve over here. You need to do prime factorization of these numbers. So I will divide all these numbers by 2. So 12 divided by 2 is 6. I cannot divide 15 by 2. So 15 as it is. 20 divided by 2 will be 10. Now I'll divide by 3. 6 divided by 3 is 2. 15 divided by 3 is 5. I cannot divide 10 by 3. So 10 as it is. Now I'll take 2. This will become 1. 5 will remain as it is. This will become 5. So 5, 1, 1, 1. So LCM is nothing but multiplication of all these numbers. So 5 to the 10, 10 3 is a 30, 30 to the 60. So 60 is the LCM. Okay. Now we will find the rate. Rate is nothing but per hour filling. So A takes 12 hours to fill 60 units. So per hour it will fill 60 divided by 12, that is 5. B takes 15 hours to fill 60 units, that is full tank. So 60 divided by 15, B's rate will be 4 units per hour. C takes 20 hours to fill 60 units. So 60 divided by 20, that is 3 units per hour. So I'll write here just for simplification. A fills 5 units per hour. B fills 4 units per hour. Okay. And C fills 3 units per hour. Now they need to fill the tank, which is of capacity 60 units. But they have given one condition. A is open all the time, while only one pipe between B and C is open for 1 hour each alternately. That means in the first hour, starting with B, they have said, so in first hour A and B will be open. In second hour A and C will be open. Again in third hour A and B will be open. And again in fourth hour A and C will be open, and so on. Okay. So now we know that A fills 5 units in 1 hour and B fills 4 units in 1 hour. So in the first hour together they will fill 9 units. A fills 5 units per hour and B fills 3 units per hour. So together they will fill 8 units in second hour. In third hour again both will fill 9 units. Fourth hour again they will fill 8 units. So just check, in fifth hour again they will fill 9 units. In 6th hour again they will fill 8 units. Check how many units have filled till now. So you can check 9 plus 8 is 17. 17. 17. So till now they have filled 51 units in 6 hours. Now in the 7th hour who will be there? In the 7th hour A and B will be there together. Right? So in this 7th hour they will fill more 9 units. So 51 plus 9 will be equal to 60 units, which is the capacity of tank. So the tank will be full in 7 hours. So the correct answer for this question is 7. Okay, check this question based on pipes and cisterns. A tank has a leak which would empty it in 10 hours. A tap is turned on which admits 4 liter a minute into the tank, and now it emptied in 12 hours. The capacity of tank is, okay, so basically they have said that there is a leakage which empties the tank in 10 hours. Then there is one tap which fills 4 liters per minute. Okay. So this tap is filling. This is emptying or removing the water out of the tank. And because of this tap, effectively, now both of them, they take 12 hours to empty the tank. Okay. So initially just imagine one situation. So suppose this is the tank, this is the leakage, and this is the tap. Okay. So when tap was not there, the leakage alone can empty the full tank in 10 hours. Now there is a tap which is putting water at the rate of 4 liters per minute in the tank. So now this overall, both of them, tap and the leakage, it is taking 12 hours to empty the tank. Previously it was taking 10 hours. Now it is taking 12 hours to empty. So they are asking us what is the capacity of the tank. So now what we'll do, we will take the capacity of tank as X. Okay. Now what we say, leakage take 10 hours to empty the capacity of tank, or I can say X liters. So I can calculate rate of leakage. Rate of leakage will be X by 10 liters per hour. So leakage is emptying at the rate of X by 10 liters per hour. Let's check the filling tap. It is putting 4 liters of water per minute. That means in 1 hour, it will put 4 into 60, that is 240 liters. So rate of this tap will be 240 liters per hour. Okay. And the effective rate, it is taking 12 hours to empty the X liters tank. So the rate at which the tank is getting empty now is X by 12 liters per hour. Okay. So now let us form one equation. Since all the pipes or leakage which take the water out of the tank, the rate will be considered negative. Okay. And all the taps which put the water in the tank, the rate will be considered positive. Okay. So X by 10 liters of water out of the tank per hour plus 240 liters of water in the tank per hour, which is leading to X by 12 liters of water out of the tank per hour. Okay. So if you solve this equation, just check what you will get. Okay. So here it will be so X will be equal to 14400 liters. Okay, so X is nothing but capacity of tank. So the capacity of tank in this question is 14400 liters. Okay, so what we have done exactly, we first calculated the rate of that leakage, then we calculated rate of that tap, and the effective rate. Effective rate is nothing but when the leakage was alone, it was taking 10 hours, but because of that tap, it is putting water in the tank. Now it is taking 12 hours. So this is the effective. Effective rate is X by 12 liters per hour. Okay. So the correct answer is 1440 liters.
Let's check this particular question from profit and loss topic. A man sells a TV set for rupees 4,800 and makes a profit of 20%. He sells another TV at a loss of 16%. If it on the whole, he neither gains nor loses, find the selling price of second TV set. So the question is interesting. Let's check what they have given. A man sells a TV set for rupees 4,800. So initial selling price of one TV set, you can say, is 4,800 and makes a profit of 20%. So first we need to check what is the cost price to calculate the exact profit in the first scenario. So as you know, the formula for selling price is CSP is equal to CP into 100 plus profit percentage divided by 100. So in this case, they have provided selling price as 4,800. Cost price we don't know. And the profit which they have provided is 20%. So 120 divided by 100. So 100 into 5, 100 into 6, 6 into 1, 6 into 800. So cost price in the first scenario, you can check 800 into 5 is 4,000. Now, what is going to be the profit in the first scenario? As we know, profit is nothing but selling price minus cost price. Selling price which they have provided was 4800. Cost price is 4000. So you can check the profit is going to be 800 rupees. Now, in the second scenario, what they have mentioned, he sells another TV at a loss of 16%. And on the whole, he neither gains nor loses. That means if there is a profit of 800 rupees in the first transaction, there should be a loss of 800 rupees in the second transaction. And what data they have provided? The loss is of 16%. So using some formulas from profit and loss, we need to calculate cost price and then selling price. So how can we do that? Now there is a formula for loss percentage. The formula for loss percentage is loss divided by cost price into 100. So in this case, they have mentioned loss is going to be 16%. Now, the loss should be 800 rupees because we have already calculated profit as 800. So, loss should be same. So, loss is 800. CP we don't know. So, I will put it as it is into 100. So, CP is going to be 16 into 1, 16 into 50. So, cost price for second TV set is 5000. So, what should be selling price to have 800 rupees loss? As you can directly calculate, if CP is 5000, if there is a loss of 800 rupees, selling price for second TV set should be 4200. So, the answer for second question is 4200. Now, let's check this question. After selling a watch, Mihir found that he had made a loss of 12%. He also found that if he sold it for 45 rupees more, he would have made a profit of 8%. The actual initial loss was what percentage of the profit earned had he sold the watch for 8% profit. So they have given us two scenarios. Initial loss was 12% and in second scenario profit was 8%. Now what we can do, we can use our basic formula related to selling price and cost price. Now let's check what is the formula for selling price. SP is equal to CP into 100 plus profit percentage divided by 100. Now, in the first scenario, what they have given, he found that he had made a loss of 12%. So, selling price they have not provided, cost price I don't know, and the profit was 12%, loss was 12% means 100 minus loss percentage, so that will become 88 by 100. So, 88 means 22 into 4, 25 into 4 is 100. So, you can say cost price is equal to 25 CP divided by 22. Or 25 SP divided by 22. Now next what they have said, he also found that had he sold it for rupees 45 more. So 45 more means initial selling price be considered as SP. So 45 more means SP plus 45 is my new selling price. He would have made a profit of 8%. Cost price would be same, so CP. And a profit of 8% I can write like 108 divided by 100. Now this is my second scenario when I have increased selling price by 45 and my profit is 8%. So what I will do, I will take a price of cost price from the first equation, like CP is equal to 25 by 22 into SP. So I will just put that value over here. So SP plus 45 is equal to, that is going to be 25 divided by 22 SP into 108 divided by 100. So as you can check, 100 means 25 into 1, 25 into 4, 4 into 1, 4 into 27. So SP plus 45 is equal to 27 SP divided by 22. So I will take 22 over here, 22 SP plus 45 into 22. No need to do immediate multiplication. Let us keep it as it is equal to 27 SP. So this is going to be 5 SP is equal to 45 into 22. So SP is going to be 45 into 22 divided by 5. So 5 into 1, 5 into 9. Selling price total or actual selling price, you can say 22 into 9 is 198 rupees. So when he initially sold it for loss of 12%, he was selling at 198 rupees. So from this, we can calculate cost price because CP is equal to 25 into selling price is 198 divided by 22. So 22 into 1, 22 into 9. So you can check cost price is going to be 225 rupees. So what is initial loss? It was 12%, but in rupees if you want to consider, CP was 225, SP was 198. So initial loss you can say it was 27 rupees. Now regarding second scenario, when the selling price was 45 rupees more, so new selling price you can say initial selling price was 198, new selling price was 45 more than that, so 198 plus 45 you can say 243 rupees. Cost price was same, which is 225 rupees. So profit in the second case you can say 18 rupees. Now what they have asked us, they have asked us the actual initial loss was what percentage of profit earned. Now initial loss you can say it was 27 rupees and we want to compare it with the profit earned. Profit earned in the second scenario is 18. So how do we calculate a percentage? Initial value, or you can say change which they are asking, divided by over here the profit which he has earned into 100. So 9 into 2, 9 into 3, 300 divided by 2 is 150 percentage. So actual initial loss was 150% of the profit earned. So just by using a simple formula of selling price, we created two equations, and based on that, we ultimately got the value of 150%, which was our answer. Now let's check this question. Mr. Thomas invested an amount of ₹13,900 divided in two different schemes, A and B, at the simple interest rate 14% and 11% per annum respectively. If the total amount of simple interest earned in 2 years be ₹3,508, what was the amount invested in scheme B? So now what has happened? Mr. Thomas was having total ₹13,900. Then he divided it in two different schemes, A and B. For A scheme, the rate of interest was 14% and B scheme it was 11%. And the time duration for both the schemes was 2 years. Now what has happened? If the total amount of simple interest earned in 2 years is ₹3,508. So what does that mean? Mr. Thomas will get simple interest for A scheme. So I can say A simple interest. Also, Mr. Thomas will get simple interest from B scheme. So addition of both the schemes they have given, or addition of simple interest from both the schemes they have given as 3508. So A simple interest of A plus simple interest of B is equal to 3508. Now how do we calculate simple interest? Simple interest is nothing but PRT divided by 100, where P is principal. Now in this case, what is going to be principal? For simple interest of A, principal is going to be A only, because A is one amount. Next, so P is principal, means A is one principal we will consider. Rate of interest they have given 14, time they have given 2 divided by 100. Plus for B, simple interest is going to be B is that value into 11 is rate of interest into 2 divided by 100 is equal to 3508. Now, if we try to solve this, still there will be a value of A and B continuously, and we only want to find out value of B. So somehow we need to eliminate or substitute value of A. How can we do this? As they have given, 13,900 is divided in A and B. So I can say A plus B is equal to 13,900. So value of A, I can replace it like 13,900 minus B. So I will just replace this value of A in this equation. So to solve this equation, what I will do, I will just keep denominator same as divided by 100. So 13,900 minus B, value of A I have taken, into 28, 14 into 2, plus 11 into 2, 22B is equal to 3508 as it is. Now I will take this 100 on the right side. And what will happen? I just need to multiply this bracket, 13,900 into 28. Okay, if I multiply this bracket, or value I am going to get is 389200. After multiplying from 13900 into 28, minus 28B as it is, plus 22B, and I will take this 100 on the right side. So it will become 350800. Minus 28B plus 22B means minus 6B. I will take that minus 6B on the right side. So that will become positive. And this will come on the left side. I just need to subtract it from 389,200 minus 350,800. If you do this calculation, you are going to get a value of 38,400. So 6B is equal to 38,400. B is going to be 38,400 divided by 6. So if you calculate it, answer is going to be 6,400. So you can check in this particular equation or question, the answer is going to be the sum which was invested in scheme B was 6,400. So just by creating one equation like simple interest of A plus simple interest of B is equal to the amount which they have given, and we got answer as 6,400. Now let's check this question. A man rides his bicycle 10 km at an average speed of 12 and again travels 12 km at an average speed of 10. What is his average speed for the entire journey approximately? So first we need to understand what is the formula for average speed. How do we calculate average speed? Average speed is nothing but total distance traveled during that journey divided by total time taken for that journey. Now what I will do, I will just draw one path over here. Okay, what they have said, a man rides his bicycle 10 km at an average of 12 kmph. So suppose this distance is 10 km and the speed which he was going through was 12 km/h. Again travels 12 km with an average speed of 10 km/h. So speed was 10 km/h, and we need to calculate the average speed. So average speed is equal to total distance. What is the total distance? Initially he traveled 10 and then 12, so total distance traveled by him was 22 km. Now what is the total time over here? Have they mentioned anything related to time? No. So what we can do, total time is equal to time taken to cover this particular distance and then time taken to cover this particular distance. So rather than writing total time, okay, what I will do, I will just replace time is equal to distance divided by speed. But we don't have a total time. So what I will do, time is equal to distance initially was 10 divided by speed was 12. Plus again distance was 12 and at that time the speed was 10. So initial time plus this time is equal to total time, I can say. So now just we need to calculate this. So to calculate it, I need to take its LCM. So this is going to be 60. Then I need to multiply this by 5, 50. And then I need to multiply this by 6. This will be 72. So 60 I will take it on numerator. So 60 into 22 divided by 122. So just if I want to calculate, divide by 2 will be 11. Over here it will be 61. So 660 divided by 61. So if you calculate it, the answer is going to be 10.8 km/h. So what we have done, we have used a simple formula of average speed, which is total distance by total time. Total distance we already knew, which was 22 km. For total time, what we did, we just added initial journey time, then later journey time. And time is nothing but distance by speed, which we replace. And then we got answer as 10.8 km/h. Now let's check this question. Two trains start at the same time from Pune and Delhi and proceed towards each other at 80 km/h and 90 km/h respectively. When they meet, it is found that one train has traveled 180 km more than the other. Find the distance between Delhi and Pune. So suppose, let me draw like this. This is from Pune and this is from Delhi. Okay. Both the trains have started at the same time and the speed was, you can say, 80 and then 95. Both traveling towards each other. Now, what has happened? When they meet, it is found that one train has traveled 180 km more than other train. So from the data which they have given, I can say time taken by Pune train is equal to time taken by Delhi train, right? Because they are starting at the same time and they are meeting then, okay? So time taken by Pune train is equal to time taken by Delhi train. So I will say time is nothing but distance by speed. So let me consider the distance traveled by Pune train as x divided by the speed of Pune train is 80. Next, the distance traveled by Delhi train will be 180 more as the data which they have given. So initial distance of Pune I have considered x, 180 more means x plus 180. And considering the distance as 95 for Delhi, this will be my equation. So now just you need to solve this. 95x is equal to 80x plus 180 into 80. Now that is going to be 15x is equal to 180 into 80. Now x is going to be 180 into 80 divided by 15. So 15 into 1, 15 into 12. You can check value of x is going to be 12 into 8 is 96, 960. So distance for Pune train, I can say it was x I have considered, which is 960. Distance for Delhi train is x plus 180. So 960 plus 180, if you calculate, it is 1140. And we need to calculate the total distance between Delhi and Pune. So distance traveled by Pune train 960, distance traveled by Delhi train is 1140. If you add this together, it is going to be 2100 km. So answer for this question is going to be A. Now let's check this question from permutation combination concept. From a group of 7 men and 6 women, 5 persons are to be selected to form a committee so that at least 3 men are there in the committee. In how many ways it can be done? So total, we need to make sure we are selecting 5 people and out of that, at least 3 men should be there. Now, at least 3 men should be there means there are 3 different possibilities, okay? So total what they have given, 7 men and then 6 women, okay? And we need to select 5 persons out of that. So at least three men means it can be three men and two women. Or another possibility can be four men and one woman can be selected. Or five men and no woman will be selected. So how to select three men out of seven? It is 7C3. How to select two women out of six? It is 6C2. Or means plus, selecting four men out of seven, this will be 7C4. Selecting one woman out of six, that will be 6C1. Plus, selecting five men from seven, this will be 7C5. Now, just we need to do a simple calculation. 7C3 we can calculate like 765 divided by 3 into 2 into 1. Okay, this is the way we do calculations for combination questions. 6C2 is nothing but 6 into 5 divided by 2. Plus 7C4 is nothing but 7 into 6 into 5 into 4 divided by 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. 6C1 is nothing but 6 plus 7C5, I can write it like 7C2. Because in permutation combination, there is a concept like 7C5 can be written as 7C2 because NCR is equal to NC N minus R. Okay, this is a calculation part. So 7C5, I can write it like 7C2, which is 7 into 6 divided by 2 into 1. Now, just let me calculate it over here. 7 into 5 is 35, 35 into 15. If you calculate it, it is 525 plus 7 into 5, 35 into 6, which is 2110 plus 21. So if you do the total calculation, answer is going to be 756. Now let's check this question. Find the least number which when divided by 5, 6, 8 and 7 leaves a remainder of 3, but when divided by 9 leaves no remainder. Now these type of questions can be solved by two methods. One of the method is finding out LCM and then checking further things, or another can be going through options. Now, one of the easy way for this particular question, I would recommend to go through option, because what they have mentioned that when that number is divided by 9 leaves no remainder. So directly check from options, is there any option after dividing it that number, whether it is leaving a remainder or not. So suppose if I say 1963, is it divisible by 9? Now, what is the divisibility rule of 9? The sum should be divisible by 9. So 10 plus 6, 16 plus 3, 19. So this number is not divisible by 9. So it will leave some remainder after dividing it by 9. Let's check this number 2523. 7 plus 2, 9. 9 plus 3, 12. So this number is also not divisible by 9. 1683. 7 plus 8, 15. 15 plus 3, 18. So this number is divisible by 9. And 1536. Like 6 plus 3, 9. 9 plus 6, 15. It is not divisible by 9. So you can check, you can save a lot of time just by going through option and checking which number is divisible by 9. There is only one number which is divisible by 9. So for this case, I can say answer is 1683. Now let's check this particular question. In one alloy, there is 60% gold in its total mass, while in another alloy, it is 35%. 12 kg of the first alloy was melted together with 8 kg of the second one to form a third alloy. Find the percentage of gold in the new alloy. So what they have mentioned, in the first type of alloy, it is total 12 kg actually, which they are going to melt. Out of that, 60% part is gold. So total gold you can say is, in the first type of alloy, is 12 kg into 60%. So 60 means this is going to be 6 divided by 10. So 72 by 10, 7.2 kg of gold in the first alloy. Next, 8 kg total alloy in the second part, and 35% out of that, 35% out of that is gold. So I can say 8 kg into 35%, so 35 divided by 100. If you calculate 8 into 35 divided by 100, it is going to be 280 divided by 100, which is 2.8 kg. So as you can check, total gold is going to be 7.2 kg plus 2.8 kg. But over here, we want to calculate the percentage in new alloy. New alloy is going to be initial first part is 12 kg and second part is 8 kg. So gold is total 10 kg out of 20 kg. So you can check, it is going to be 50% in new alloy. So initially it was 7.2 in first alloy. In the second alloy, it is 2.8. So total 10 kg in new alloy. and new alloy mixture is total 20 kg. So answer is going to be 50%. Now let's check this question based on simple interest concept. Ram invested rupees 25,000 at a certain rate of simple interest per annum. Ram's investment becomes 75,000 in a period of 9 years. In how many years Ram's investment will become 2,25,000? So first thing, before starting, you need to know what is the formula of simple interest, which is PRT divided by 100. In this case, initially he invested 25,000, so principal is clear, 25,000. Rate of interest we don't know, and initial time they have given is 9 years, so divided by 9 into 9 divided by 100. Now what is simple interest? Simple interest is the extra money which he is going to get. So 75,000 is not the simple interest. Initially he invested 25,000 and it becomes 75,000. So total extra money which he got was 50,000. So I can say simple interest is 50,000 in the first situation. So from this we can obtain what is the rate of interest. So just calculate 25,000 into 1, 25,000 into 2. So rate of interest is going to be 200 divided by 9%. And next what they have asked, in how many years Ram's investment will be 2,25,000. So you can check total investment initial was 25,000 and now it should become 2,25,000. So what should be the simple interest in that case? Simple interest in that case should be 2 lakh rupees. Is equal to principal is same, 25,000. Rate of interest we just calculated, which is 200 divided by 9 into time we need to calculate now, divided by 100. So just solve this particular equation. 25,000 into 1, 2 lakh is into 8. 100 into 1, 100 into 2. So answer for this question is going to be 8 is equal to 2 by 9. So 2 into 1, 2 into 4. Answer is going to be 36 years. Or even you could have done like initial investment was increased by 50,000 and it took 9 years to increase. And to increase it by 2 lakh rupees, which is 4 times of this amount, it should be 36 years. How we can do this? Because simple interest increases uniformly. So for 50,000 it is taking 9 years. So that means for 2 lakh rupees it will take 36 years. Now let's check this particular question from compound interest. A bank offers 5% compound interest calculated on half yearly basis. A customer deposits rupees 1600 each on 1st January and 1st July of a year. At the end of year, the amount he would have gained by the way of interest. So this particular question belongs to compound interest, where initially he put 1600 on 1st January and later on he again put 1600 on 1st July. Okay, so let's check how we can solve this question. Now the basic formula for compound interest, the way which we calculate is amount is equal to principal, in bracket it is 1 plus rate of interest, since it is half yearly I need to divide it by 2, divided by 100, bracket raised to NT, where N is the value of half yearly means value of N is going to be 2. Now two things we need to understand. First thing is 1600 was kept for entire year, which was put on the 1st January. Okay, so I will write it over here. Amount after 1 year on 1600 rupees at 5% half yearly. Okay, so initially he put 1600 rupees. So let me just put values in the formula. Okay, amount is equal to principal is 1600. In bracket 1 plus rate of interest is going to be 5 by 2, which is 2.5 divided by 100. Value of N is going to be 2 and timing is going to be 1 because we are considering for complete 1 year. So if I solve this, 2.5 into 1, this is going to be 40. So this is nothing but going to be 40 plus 1, 41 by 2, 41 by 40 bracket square. So I can say it is 1600 and in bracket it is going to be 41 by 40 bracket square. So now what has happened? On 1st January he put 1600 and this is the amount which he is going to get after 1 year. But on 1st July also he has put again 1600. So I can say amount after half year, because the amount which he is investing on 1st July will remain for half year. 1600 rupees at 5% half yearly. So how we can calculate it? Again, amount is going to be, principal is same 1600, in bracket it is going to be 1 plus r by 2 will be again same, since we are calculating half yearly, so that will be 2.5 divided by 100. Value of n is going to be same because it is half yearly, but value of time will be 1/2, since we are calculating it for half year, because money which he is putting on 1st July will remain for 1 year, 1.5 year only, so 1/2. So now just calculate, 2 and 2 will get cancelled. This is going to be 2.5 into 40. So this amount you can check, 1600, and then it will be 41/40. So what we need to do, just we need to calculate the total amount which he is going to receive. So total amount I can say, just I will write it over here. Amount which he receive from the money which he will put on 1st January. This one is that amount. Okay, so 1600, and in bracket it is 41/40 bracket square, plus amount which he will receive for the amount which he will put on the 1st July. And this is that amount, 1600, and in bracket it is 41/40. Okay, so what I will do, I can just take 1600 common from this, right? Or you can do it from various methods. So suppose if I take 1600 and 41/40 as common from both these numbers, so what will remain over here, 41/40, and over here 1 will remain, right? So if I calculate this, this is 41/40 plus 1, so this will become like 1600 into 41/40, and this will be 41 plus 40, which will be 81 divided by 40. Now if I calculate this, 40 into 40 is 1600. So what is remaining? 41 into 81. 41 into 81 means total amount after 1 year is going to be 41 into 81, which is, if you calculate, 3,321. And can you tell me what is the amount which he invested? So total principal, initially 1600 and then again 1600 on 1st July. So total he invested 3,200 rupees. So what is compound interest? Compound interest is nothing but amount minus principal. So amount is 3,321 minus 3,200. Answer is going to be 121. Thank you everyone for watching this particular video. If you are having any doubt, please comment on this video. If you like this particular video, please click on the like button and do press on the bell icon to get the notifications. We also post various campus related updates on our Telegram group. I have added a link in the description box. All the very best for your NLTH exam. Thank you.